Good evening, everyone. It is my great pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Dr. Brian Treanor. Brian started at LMU in 2001 as visiting assistant professor, and by 2003, he officially joined the Department of Philosophy and has been a visible, respected member of the LMU community ever since. I first met Brian in 1999, where we were both graduate students at a Levinas conference at Emory University. The continental philosophical world is quite small, but it is still beautiful that we were both destined to be professors and colleagues at LMU. For the past 20 years, Brian and I have kept things good in French in the department. And we've also both share a love of the American philosophical tradition. Tonight we celebrate Melancholic Joy, On Life Worth Living, Brian's third monograph. Compared to his previous two books, both of which were excellent, Aspects of Alterity, Levinas, Marcel, and the Contemporary Debate in 2006, and In Plotting Virtue, a Narrative Approach to Environmental Virtue Ethics in 2014, Melancholic Joy is a book that, as I read it, sounds exactly like Brian Treanor. Those of you who've already read it, you can literally hear Brian speaking to you. There comes a time when a philosopher stops writing books about philosophy and starts writing philosophical books. This book is definitely in the latter category. Here we see Treanor philosophizing, and dare I say with all his being. A mixture of philosophy, especially continental philosophy of religion, literature, poetry, and his love of the great outdoors, one cannot but hope to be the kind of embodied, integrated, and comprehensive thinker that Brian demonstrates in this book. I remember when Brian started thinking about this book. He wondered then why philosophers always focus on death, loss, anxiety, my favorite subjects, instead of joy, risk, and adventure. This book is the fruition of that idea. The job of the philosopher is quite simple. Ask a question, and then answer it. The hard part is actually doing this simple job. Melancholic Joy reminds me that following wherever inquiry and truth leads us results in beautiful work, and that's what every philosopher hopes deep in their hearts when they write. Reading the book, or even just hearing his presentation tonight, will easily convince you that LMU was indeed right in awarding him the prestigious Fritz B. Burns Teaching Award in 2011, that LMU was right in naming him the founding director of the Academy for Catholic Thought and Imagination in 2015, and indeed right in bestowing him with the Charles S. Casassa Chair of Social Values in 2015. With 3 manuscripts, 6 edited volumes, almost 60 articles and book chapters, over 150 conference presentations and invited talks, and thousands of well-taught students and informed interlocutors. I dare say Brian is one of my generation. Brian and I are in this kind of middle generation in American continental philosophy right now. I dare say he's one of our generation's most prolific continental philosophers. And he's still so young and has so much more in the pipeline. We can only look forward to what he will give us in the future. As he writes on page 114 of Melancholic Joy, this is the human vocation to love and celebrate and give thanks for the world, the miracle that things are rather than are not, and the incomparable gift that we are here to witness it. Indeed, we are here tonight to love and celebrate and give thanks for Brian's work. This miraculous fact that being is, and I hope that tonight indeed we all will receive an incomparable gift and that we are grateful to be here to witness it. So I encourage us all to find joy tonight, melancholic joy, as it were, as you hear from my beloved colleague, tonight's speaker, Dr. Brian Treanor.
Thank you very much. You should always have your friends introduce you. That said a lot. Brad and I did come here together, and I really appreciate his thoughts. The two of us came here together with Jason in the same year, and it's been really nice to be able to pursue my work, not just with my students here, who there's a couple of different generations of undergraduates and graduates here, but also with colleagues that I really value and have really enriched my own thinking here. So I want to appreciate that. Rhonda and Brad and I had schemed, I was going to start this with a little exercise because, 2 minutes ago, sun was setting, and I was going to have us all stand to sort of look at the sunset from here, but the skies rolled in. So we can just imagine that we're looking at the sunset back there, and I was going to use the occasion to start with a poem that kind of captures one aspect of what's happening in the book. So this is Denise Levertov's Once Only. All which, because it was flame and song and granted us joy, we thought we'd do, be, revisit, turns out to have been what it was that once, only. Every initiation did not begin a series, a buildup. The marvelous did happen in our lives. Our stories are not drab with its absence, but don't expect now to return for more. Whatever more there will be unique, as those were unique. Try to acknowledge the next song in its body halo of flame as utterly present, now or never. And the sun goes down, and it would have been the perfect moment to do this thing here. But all right, I've got some notes written out, but I'm not going to read them to you. I'll try and keep this to about 20, 25 minutes, and then we're going to have Q&A, which is the best part of this thing, to engage with all of you as well. It's difficult for me to try and summarize this book in 20 or 25 minutes, not because it's particularly good, but because it is dealing with big questions. Right? It's not taking a small question and trying to analyze it, which also has its place, but it's dealing with big questions, and it tries to do so in an interdisciplinary way, right? Insofar as I'm capable of doing that. The summary is made more difficult because I'm not really making an argument in a formal sense in this book, right? I'm rather offering a vision for your consideration. An invitation to look and see, as Arizm Kohak says in his own book. There's no conclusion here, really, because I don't reason through an argument that comes to an end, which is what conclusion would mean. There's no denouement because I don't unknot anything. I don't really think the knot of the human condition can be undone. I think we have to learn to live with the knotty, messy, contradictory reality of the human condition. So, first, a word about despair. I wrote this book because, as Brad said, continental philosophy and our culture more broadly seems to me to be captivated by a kind of pessimism. And I myself, as Brad also suggested, I'm easily captured by that way of looking at things, by thinking of what could go wrong about the problems in the world. Plato claimed that philosophy begins in wonder, but Simon Critchley, another continental philosopher that a number of us know, points out rightly, I think, that philosophy today begins in the experience of disappointment. So Plato, it began with the experience of wonder, but today, in a post-World War I, post-World War II, largely Western tradition of philosophy, it begins in disappointment. Popular culture, I think, as well, literature and film is caught up in an orgy of dystopian fantasy. My daughters are in their late teens and grew up with reams of young adult literature that was pretty dark. Now, I think there are really good reasons for this. I could spend the next 25 minutes really rubbing our noses in the reasons to despair, right? Give a trigger warning and just go really deep down the dark rabbit hole. But just a few things to think about. Personal reasons. Even for privileged, successful, and optimistic people, life is marked, perhaps even inextricably characterized, by monotony, boredom, impotence, fallibility, suffering, all lived under the specter of an inescapable death. Levertov is right. The marvelous does happen in our lives, but most of what happens, the vast majority of it, is at best boring or monotonous and often anxiety-producing or painful. As Oscar Wilde put it, the secret of life is suffering. It's what's hidden behind everything. On a social level, the 20th century was an abattoir. Today, the doomsday clock is stuck at 90 seconds to midnight, the closest it's ever been. Yes, things have improved in many respects, as some of my good friends who are here have tried to remind me, and we can talk about that in the Q&A. But although things have improved in many respects, they've improved in many respects for humans, maybe not for the rest of the world, they're still quite bad. Think about COVID-19, think about the Ukraine. And they could and may well get much, much worse. Think about climate change, or think about the next pandemic being H5N1 instead of COVID-19. And then in the background of all this, a sort of cosmic reason for pessimism, which is entropy destroys everything. The Musica Universalis is played in a minor key. Finally, when we take finally seriously, nothing lasts, nothing matters. The world is full of sound and fury signifying nothing. At least this is the argument. I'm going to qualify this before you guys get too targeted. We could endure the sound and the fury, but the signifying nothing leaves an incurable wound. Cormac McCarthy writes in The Road, which I'm sure some of you have read, he, the protagonist, walked out in the gray light and stood, and he saw for a brief moment the absolute truth of the world. The cold, relentless circling of the intestate earth, darkness implacable, the blind dogs of the sun in their running, the crushing black vacuum of the universe, and somewhere two hunted animals trembling like ground foxes in their cover. Borrowed time and borrowed world and borrowed eyes with which to sorrow it. Now there's a tendency to dismiss this kind of thinking, among other people I've spoken to, as melodramatic, as the province of angsty teenagers. But I think the reasons for despair are deadly serious, and that anyone who doesn't see it, anyone who does not feel it in her gut, has either A, not thought about it carefully enough, or B, is hiding from the truth, about which more in a moment. Gabriel Marcel, who's a far cry from contemporaries like Sartre, Camus, or Chiaron, wrote that we must come to terms with the fact that reality in some way counsels despair, makes the case for it, argues for it, whispers it into our ears when we're alone. If I had time for another poem, I'd try, I don't have this one memorized, I'd read you Philip Larkin's Obeyed. I started Melancholic Joy well before COVID, but I trust now everyone realizes how precarious our good fortune really is, how fragile our health, our democracy, our well-being, our climate, our happiness. So I think that there are truly awful things about the world that we need to face, and about the human condition, more awful than most people are willing to face and come to terms with from the dubious and temporary citadel of their good fortune. The question is, how should we deal with this? Right? As a side note, my wife, who's joined us tonight, had quipped for multiple years while I was working on this that I was writing this book because I was too cheap to pay for therapy. So I wanted to try and sort of work my way out of what I've just described to you. This is the first chapter, but we're not going to stay there. After the opening chapter, that goes really all in cataloging the reasons to despair, the next four chapters all explore different experiences that might, in some way, mitigate against that despair. And those four categories are joy, vitality, hope, and love. None of these phenomena, on my reading, defeat evil or overcome the reasons for despair. They are rather additional data points, so to speak, in deciding whether or not reality counsels despair. I won't be able to talk about all this tonight, so let me say something very brief about vitality, hope, and love, so that I can say something a bit more about joy before wrapping up. So I'm just going to skip through the first three pretty quickly. Vitality is my term for speaking about the experience of our embodied insertion into the material world. Philosophy has generally treated this in terms of the ways in which our bodies are limited, the ways in which they fail us or deceive us, the inevitability of their decay and their death. I, however, explore embodiment in terms of our fittedness for the world, the way our body in the world tells us that we belong here, that this is our home. The body has its own kind of insight and wisdom, and it reveals certain kinds of truths that we tend to miss when pursuing the goal of disembodied rationality, which is a big hallmark of philosophy. I treat hope not in terms of wish fulfillment for the future, as Robinson Jeffers quips in a poem called The Answer, "We should not be duped by dreams of universal justice or happiness. These dreams will not be fulfilled." But rather in terms of affirmation of and fidelity to what is here and now. Not a hope for something that may or may not happen, and all this will eventually fail, but rather a hope in some particular reality, a person, a place, a world, ultimately in reality itself. So the distinction between hope for and hope in. And then I discuss love in a variety of different ways, but build towards a reflection on a particular kind of love, appreciative love, that is, so far as we know, this is maybe for any of my students from class this semester, so far as we know, distinctive of human beings. The human beings are the beings that can love the world appreciatively. Appreciative love is disinterested love for a thing itself, for its intrinsic goodness, independent of any good it has for me, independent of any relationship it has to me. I developed this theme in a number of ways, but particularly with respect to more than human nature, where I think because of its inhuman otherness, we find or are called to appreciate love more often and more clearly than in other circumstances. So I'm happy to circle back to any of those if it sort of lit a little spark in someone's head, vitality, hope, or love. But let's spend a moment thinking a bit more carefully about joy. One of the ways in which philosophy has dealt with the issues that lead to despair is captured in the problem of evil, which a bunch of the students here have probably covered either with philosophy professors or with theology professors. And I want to talk about it a little bit tonight. Classically formulated, the problem of evil confronts us with the apparent contradiction between God's attributes as all-knowing, all-powerful, and all-good, and the evident existence of evil in the world. So, the problem. God's all-knowing, omniscient, all-powerful, omnipotent, and all-good, omnibenevolent, and nevertheless, babies get cancer. Relatives get Alzheimer's, right? What's going on? Here's a quick clip that I use in the second chapter that I think is just a punch in the gut every time I see this film. This is from the Irish film Cavalry, for those folks who haven't seen it yet. Hopefully the volume's right here.
You know, when I first started out working up in Dublin, there was this three-year-old boy. Parents brought him into the hospital for a routine operation, like. But the anaesthetist made a mistake. The little boy ended up deaf, dumb, blind, and paralyzed for good, like. Think of it. Think when that little boy first regained consciousness. In the dark. We'd be frightened, wouldn't you? We'd be frightened. In the kind of a way that you know that the fear is going to end. Has to. Must. The parents couldn't be too far away. They'll come to your rescue. They'll turn the light on, they'll talk to you. But, think of it, nobody comes to rescue you. No light is turned on. You are in the dark. You try to speak, but you can't. You try to move, but you can't. You try to cry out, but you were unable to hear your own screams. You You are entombed within your own body, howling with terror.
So that's the problem of evil, right? In a tough way. I kind of modify it in the book. Whoops. There are traditional responses to it. The most prominent one is theodicy. I'm going to pick up the pace here, given the time. Right? The way that you deal with the problem of evil is by eliminating one of the contradictory lines. So if you say God is all powerful and all good, but he's not all knowing, it's a deus abscondus, God has created everything and then taken off, and when he comes back, he's going to be really messed about what we did on the weekend while he was on vacation. Right? So he doesn't realize what's happening, so then there's not a contradiction. Maybe God's all-knowing and all-good, but not all-powerful. There's a bunch of people who write about weak theologies in which they give up God's omnipotence to sort of preserve God's goodness. And then the nightmare scenario is God's all-knowing and all-powerful, but not all-good. God's Zeus or something like that, who abducts people and rapes them and kills them and things like that. That does away with the problem. But I find theodicy unsatisfying. It's a bitter draught to drink. Bitter. Because you've got to look at things like the story Dr. Hart here tells about the boy and say, yes, that's part of a perfectly good plan, somehow. And in any case, I wanted to write this book to address the widest possible audience, and therefore I wrote it without leaning on any particular religious responses to this problem. I've got my own opinions about philosophy of religion, but I was trying to bracket them for this book. Some of you might ask reasonably, if I don't believe in God, there's no problem. No problem of evil for me. I'm not a theist. Well, yes and no. I think it's true that an agnostic or an atheist or a theist of a different stripe might not be confronted with evil as a personal affront and obscenity, as an abandonment by a personal God. But Susan Nyman points out that anyone who says ought has stepped on a path that leads straight to the problem of evil. So if you ever use the word ought, that ought not to have happened. You're already committed to needing to solve this kind of problem. So evil's in the world. We experience it ourselves. It seems inescapable. How can we explain it or deal with it? I want to say that evil's not a problem we can solve. We can and we should attempt to combat specific instances of evil, to ameliorate the suffering that we can't ameliorate. But we're fools to think that we can eliminate evil itself, escape finitude, evade entropy. Evil's not a problem, using a distinction Marcel makes again. It's a mystery. Problems are obstacles that we can overcome, or we have overcome, and they're generally overcome with some kind of technical solution that we can use. Mysteries are realities in which we're implicated and involved. Is life worth living? You can't ask that as if it's not a question for you. Do I love so-and-so? Mysteries cannot be solved, strictly speaking, and they're certainly not technical in nature. And I'll wager that if we're attentive, we should probably think of this problem not as the problem of evil, not as the mystery of evil, but rather as the mystery of the good. That is to say, the real conundrum here is, how do we cope with the presence of some evil in a world that is otherwise so obviously, blindingly good, if we just pay attention to it? So I've got one other little movie clip for you here, and I'll try and keep mindful of time. This is from Terrence Malick's Tree of Life, if Sue's out there somewhere.
A man's paths, there are two ways through life. The way of nature, and the way of grace. You have to choose which one you'll follow. Grace doesn't try to please itself. Accepts being slighted, forgotten, disliked. Accepts insults and injuries. Nature only wants to please itself. Get others to please it too.
In loving and faithful. the service.
Likes to lord it over them.
Bless these boys.
To have its own way. It finds reasons to be unhappy while all the world is shining around it. And love is smiling through all things.
So that's the hook there at the end, is that the people who give into a kind of pessimistic miserabilism, including myself, right, are people who find reasons to fixate on the suffering when the glory is happening all around us, if we can just open our eyes to it. So I'm going to pick this up a little bit, again, looking at the time. Did we start a tad late? I think I was going this slowly. Real quickly to respond to, we did?
Okay.
Real quickly to respond to the problem of evil, because this I think is useful for discussion to give you something to pull on. I think what's important about the way I'm thinking of it is the way that the problem of evil is normally solved, right? To go back a few slides. This is the traditional solution to the problem of evil. God's omniscient, omnipotent, omnibenevolent. Evil doesn't exist. The things that we think of as evil, the things we complain about as evil, we're misapprehending them. They're not really evil because it was all created perfectly. There's a value to this kind of thinking. I'm not rejecting it entirely, but in the book I'm trying to bracket the theological assumptions that underpin this and say, well, what's going on here is an argument like this. Evil exists, but... Right? And every time you hear that in a sentence, it's like, I'm not a racist, but, right? You know what's coming after that. So I want to replace the but with an and, right? Not torture and genocide and cancer and Alzheimer's are evil, but torture and genocide and cancer and Alzheimer's are evil. They are evil. It sucks that people suffer those things. It's awful. And what? And nevertheless, the glory of life, love, beauty, joy, and wonder are seemingly, if we're attentive to them, inextinguishable. As Marilyn Robinson writes in Gilead, which you should all read, there are 1,000 reasons to live this life. Every one of them sufficient. Okay. The understanding that we glean from the and is unlike the explanation proffered by the but. The and does not claim that we can escape, solve, or explain evil. It doesn't downplay or dismiss the reality of suffering. At best, it helps us to cope with evil by reminding us of the background of goodness against which evil takes place. Okay, so the final conclusion here, and then we can get to discussion. So what does this look like in practice? How can we do this? How can we live in a world in which we all suffer? Everyone here suffers and is going to suffer more. Right? How do we live in that life without succumbing to despair? I want to take a cue from a philosopher named Paul Ricoeur, who in talking about faith says, look, a lot of people begin life with a certain kind of childlike faith when you're a little kid growing up, right? It could be faith in religion. It could be faith in your parents. As a teenager, maybe it's a kind of political faith. And a lot of times that first innocent, naive faith is shattered at some point, right? Something horrible happens, and your five-year-old faith that God is in heaven and all is right with the world gets a kick in the belly. Or the politician that you admired is pulled out because of some, what's the word I'm looking
scandal.
For? Scandal. Thank you so much. So that first faith is destroyed in a way, right? Now, what comes after that? When your faith is destroyed, you might despair. That happens. It does happen to people. The theist becomes an atheist. The passionate political person becomes apolitical and destroyed. But there's another option, right? Okay. The standard options to this kind of loss of faith about the world, about despair, about melancholia, are denial. So some people try and deny it. Right? You start off thinking the world is great, and then something awful happens in your life, and you try and deny it. You try to pretend you haven't seen what you've seen. But as Huxley reminds us in a different context, a mind expanded by new experience can never go back to its old dimension. Other people try to get by with some form of distraction, Consumerism seems to be the preferred method for many Americans. You can buy your way to bliss, or at least try to do so. Others opt for work, become a workaholic, even if it's meaningless work, just to keep busy. So you've got no time for big questions. Hedonism, generally of a shallow and timid variety, is another popular option. All of these buttressed by a kind of willed ignorance that tries not to think about the bad things. Just not gonna look at the homeless people on the street. I'm not gonna look at the injustice that I see. I'm not gonna think about other things. When the joy of first naivete shattered, some small number may actually despair, but since true despair is unendurable, ending either quickly with the pistol or slowly by the bottle, that's not really a sustainable response either, right? So what is a possible response? Working on Paul Ricoeur's model, you can, after doubt in your faith, after your first faith is shattered, you can reclaim your faith in what he calls a second naivete. That doesn't mean going back to it blindly and trying to believe again like the child, right? It means going back in light of the things that caused you to lose faith in the first place and to consciously, willfully re-embrace it. To give a non-religious example, a spouse who's betrayed, right, her faith or his faith in the partner, their faith in the partner, is destroyed, right? There's been some deep, profound betrayal. The consequence there may well be divorce. Everyone moves on, right? Lives are shattered. But it's also possible that they navigate the crisis towards some new kind of reconciliation, some new relationship, after which they love each other again. It's not the way they loved each other before what happened, but it's another naivete, right? It's choosing the naivete of, I love this person. I believe in God. I believe life is worth living despite the suffering. So in the case of joy too and melancholia, I think we can come to a second naivete. In order to do so, we have to cultivate new eyes that can look at the world differently. I don't really like Malick's way of grace, way of nature distinction here, which he pulls from Thomas Kempe's Imitation of Christ. But if we were to preserve that, we can choose to look at the world with the way of grace rather than the way of nature. I don't have too much time to explain this. Pierre Hadot speaks of this in terms of simultaneously seeing things as if for the first time, with the wonder of a child seeing something for the first time, and as if for the last time. Someone with a day left to live, a week left before being shipped to the front lines in the Ukraine. Right? The way the food tastes, the way your last embrace with someone feels. It's a conscious decision to acknowledge and engage and appreciate the heartening aspects of existence alongside the baleful. It is possible, standing at the edge of the abyss after looking all the reasons for nihilism and pessimism and despair straight in the face, after acknowledging the persistence of irredeemable and inexplicable suffering, after accepting the long, dark, inhuman indifference of deep time, it's still possible to turn to the world again and say with the poet Ellen Bass, yes, I will take you. I will love you again. Right? And that's what the book is about. It's not about some joy that we get after melancholia. We can sweep it into the dustbin, hide it in the closet, not look at it anymore. That comes at too high a price for myself. I'm sorry to leave you here, but that, I think, is what we get. That's the joy of an aware adult. And I think it is a joy. I don't think of this, as Brad was saying, I don't think of this as a sad book. I think of it as a broken world, but I think we can be joyful in it. We've got responsibilities for the brokenness as well, but we can be joyful in it. I think my readers, my friends, we should all be both more heartbroken and sad for the ways in which suffering and loss seem to be woven into the fabric of being. And at the very same time, be much more grateful and joyful for the miracle that things are rather than are not, the incredible beauty of it all, and as Brad said, the incomparable gift. We are here to witness it, even for a short time.
I would just like to say also that I have a colleague here in the library who is a philosophy major, and nobody's been able to shut him up for the last couple weeks because he read your book, and he says, if there's one book to be read about philosophy, this is it. So I just want to put that one on record for you. The outreach team has prepared some questions for Dr. Treanor, so we're going to sit here and chat a bit, and then we'll open it up to the rest of you. So many of you may have seen the article in the Loyola with Dr. Treanor, and in that article, he noted that it took him perhaps 3 to 4 times longer to write this book than any of his others. And so I would like him to talk about this journey a little bit more, and why was this book so different?
Good. I'll try and keep these direct, and then you can follow up if you want, or we can also get to. So I think, as Brad said, it was a very personal book for me. I mean, and it felt like the stakes were higher because of that. I mean, to some degree, I can overplay this with my colleagues. Dean Crabtree really likes to needle me for being the melancholic Irishman, and I can sort of play that up a bit at school, but it is, you know, it is part of who I am and the way I think. But I've also been privileged and blessed and lucky and all sorts of things to experience moments that are absolutely transcendent and joyful. And I want to in the book, and I want to in my own way of living, honor sort of both those sorts of things. So it took, it was long for that, and then the other reason it was long is I really kind of basically talked myself into a depression by writing the first chapter. That I had to work my way back out of.
Well, thank God you did, that's what I say. So you encourage your students to develop a rich intellectual and cultural life beyond the classroom. Can you please talk to our audience, which includes many students, past, present, and future, about the importance of interdisciplinarity?
Yeah, I think it's important. So I think there's lots of different ways people can be intellectuals, right? And I think that there are some people may know the famous Isaiah Berlin essay about hedgehogs and foxes, right? Hedgehogs get one idea and they go really, really deep with it, and foxes run across the surface of many different ideas, only going fairly shallow beneath ground for any one of them. I'm just a foxy thinker and not a hedgehoggy thinker, right?
Really?
Yeah, so I bounce around between different ideas, I think. And I think that there's value in both those sorts of ways of proceeding, but to me, I think it's really important if I'm asking a question. Some of my work's in environmental philosophy, right? To do environmental philosophy just as a philosopher without talking to people who do biology and ecology and hydrology and other things like this just seems like trying to answer a question with one eye shut or something like that. And I've had really good experiences with colleagues here in the English department, in the French department, in the theology department. I've had the opportunity to team teach a few times, and to me, it always just makes the inquiry much more interesting than pursuing it with just a single perspective. I mean, maybe the one eye shut is the best sort of analogy to that, but my colleagues here in philosophy know that the kind of way I do philosophy comes from this tradition called hermeneutics, and this is not to suggest that any view of things could be true. But there are an infinite number of ways to view something, an infinite number of perspectives that might be true about something. Not anything's true. The analogy I use for students really quickly, and then we can move on, is that if we were reading a book together, right, Joyce's Ulysses or Proust or Moby Dick or something like that, there are, I think quite literally, an infinite number of true interpretations of Moby Dick. But we can still look at some interpretations and say, well, that's just wrong. It's out there. It's not part of that range. But my commitment to the infinite number of true interpretations is part of the reason I want to think in an interdisciplinary way, and part of the reason I want to do philosophy with students and colleagues.
As I was reading through the book, you obviously pull from literature, from film, from poetry. You know, when you were which came first, you know, the chicken or the egg? Did you find all these examples and fit it in, or did you have your thoughts and then looked outside for
yeah,
it.
Okay, so here's a funny serendipity. So when I was a serious late bloomer intellectually and academically, my students here know I can kind of ride them pretty hard about like being serious undergraduates and students. I was not. So I took off a lot of time. I had been overseas living for a while. And when I came back to the States, because my then girlfriend, now wife, was a graduate student at UCLA, I came back to LA, which I don't think I would have done otherwise. And I wanted to go into a graduate, a terminal MA program, just so I had other intelligent people to think through ideas with. And I thought really seriously about doing creative writing, because I was going to be creative writing or philosophy. And Nick McKeon Ethics tipped the scale for philosophy. So I came to philosophy and really went all in with that once I got into it for a while. And then, we'll make the story quick, a few years back, I can't remember how many now because I'm middle-aged, I tried to start a living learning community on campus for the Great Books, a Great Books living learning community, right? And a colleague of mine in the philosophy department, Martin Emilianu, his father or mother is a literature professor, father. He went home for Christmas and mentioned this in the course of a dinner or drink, and his father, who's an immigrant, was like, ugh, you Americans and your lists of great books. If, like a normal educated person, you read 60 books a year, you would come across the books that were great, and you would develop a taste for great books, and you wouldn't need a list for people to tell you. And I was like, okay, all right, 60 books a year, right? And so I can't remember what year this was, 2015 or 2016. I was like, I'm going to read 60 books this year that have nothing to do with work. Right? And so, and a bunch of months, like I finally finished the sixth volume of Proust. I did Middlemarch, I did a couple of big doorstopper books, and I also did a bunch of shorter ones, and I finished the 60th book on the night of December 28th that year. And I've kept it up since then, not 60 a year. There were some years with 30, 45, 52. But I keep track of the books I read now. And it really reignited in me a love of literature and poetry that I'd always had, but that I now really integrated into my work in a different way. So thank you, Nemoyano Sr. for
I'm not surprised that you were considering creative writing, because your book truly is poetic. I mean, it is lovely writing. So for all of you out there, just a little bit of tidbit. Okay, so in reading about the concept vitality, right, you're attempting to give voice or words to that which language fails to encapsulate. Mm-hmm. So can you describe your process for describing the indescribable?
So this is where I think poetry works, right? I think poetry is an attempt to, as Samuel Beckett said, F the ineffable, right? That's what poetry is trying to do. It's trying to say indirectly what can't be said directly. And even poetry, I think, fails ultimately. But I do suspect for some of the things, one of the philosophers I read a lot, I don't know if Lily, I saw David here earlier, Michel Serre. Michel Serre says, only philosophy goes deep enough to show that poetry goes still deeper than philosophy, right? On some of these questions. And here's an example, I think, a humorous one. And for students who have heard this anecdote before, I'm sorry. A really good friend of mine in graduate school, Andrew, came from a working class family in Florida. He was like first generation to go to school, classic scholar, philosophy student, came home the summer after his freshman year and was at his father's house in a trailer park. His father was a cop in Florida. So thin walls, small room, and he's reading a book one day in the living room, and his father and stepmother are in the kitchen of the trailer park. And so you can imagine in your heads here, like the water running, the dishes clinking as they're washing the dishes, and Andrew all of a sudden hears, not intending to eavesdrop, John, how come you never say you love me? Water's running, dishes are clinking, pause. Well, I told you once, if I change my mind, I'll let you know. Right? Now, the reason that's funny and horrifying is that when we say to the people we love, I love you, like, that doesn't capture it. I mean, pick your favorite poet. Pick your favorite poet, your favorite musician, and think of how effectively they've communicated their love for someone. It still doesn't capture it. It is, I mean, for students who don't know the words, it's ineffable. It can't be caught in language. But I think the things that matter the most, the things that are ineffable, the things that we can't stop talking about. God, love, meaningfulness, like those are things we are never going to get to the end of talking about. But the solution is not, with respect for people who know Wittgenstein, you know, whereof we cannot speak, thereof we must remain silent. The solution is rather, no, talk about it again and again and again in a different way, from a different perspective. So that, I think,
is...
Yeah. But although, yeah. Never will, but yeah.
That's okay. Right, exactly. So what does the reflective process look like in writing this book? And how do you balance reflective practice with the responsibilities of life?
I have to try and answer this question every time I apply for a grant, right? A lot of grant proposals for the humanities try to make us sound like scientists. Like, what's your method? Well, I read and I talk to friends and then I... but how do I balance it with... Maybe an easier thing for me to latch onto there is, how do I balance it with the demands of life? Not well. Not well. It's difficult. It's difficult to pursue multiple things in life passionately, right? It's difficult to be the best teacher you can be, and the best scholar you can be, and the best husband, and the best son, and the best father, and it's really hard in life, as I'm sure students understand. You guys are all really busy. It's hard to juggle multiple things. It's true for your faculty members as well. I'm not sure what to say to that, except you try to strike a balance in life and try and strike the right balance.
And is it something that you can teach your students?
Don't be like me. Like, I'm a bad model. Is Lily here tonight? So Lily, who's my TA, and like so far and away the best TA I've had in 20 years of being here. I feel like I'm scarring her because I'm sending her emails at 1 or 2 in the morning, and she's horrified. Like, why are you awake? What are you doing at 1 in the morning? She's about to go to a PhD program, and yeah, I mean, it's work-life balance is hard, like especially for intellectual life, because there's no one puts up guardrails for you. You've got to put them up for yourself. So you've got to say, I'm not working this weekend. I'm leaving the computer at home, and I'm going with the family to Yosemite or something. But because the way it works in academia, and I'm sure it may be true in law or other kind of intellectual fields, is there's no one who's going to tell you it's enough, right? So it always feels like you've got to do more. Don't do that, right? Read some Thoreau. So read Tolstoy's Death of Ivan Illich, read Thoreau's Walden, and read Somerset Maugham's The Razor's Edge, right? And tell yourself that you should not be a productive worker bee all the time. It's bad.
There you go. I like that. Okay, my last question. Now I'll open it up to the rest of you. So you hold nature as a great educator. One might go so far as to assert that you contend that out of a profound experience with nature, we learn the truth about love. You say, quote, "This is the human vocation, to love and celebrate and give thanks for the world, the miracle that things are rather than are not, and the incomparable gift that we are here to witness it." Can you speak to the interplay between nature, love, vitality, and your ethic of care?
Okay, that's good. Let me try and bite off a part of it. So the way I came to that chapter, this was another long pause in writing the book, right? So I realized there was no way to write this book without writing about love, because love is probably the single best piece of armor against the slings and arrows of fate, against despair, right? But what can I say about love? Like, so much has been written about it by people who are so much wiser than I am. There's libraries and libraries of it. It was just too much for me. And then the way I find my way out of that is thinking, well, I'm not going to write about love completely. I'm just going to write about a narrow aspect of it. And I say at some point in the book, look, the most obvious place all of us would think about love mitigating against despair would be our love for our families, right? My wife, my daughters, my friends. But other people have spoken to that, I think, more thoroughly and better than I could, right? And so I thought about love of nature, where a lot of people, in philosophy at least, I won't say denigrate, but sort of give that a secondary kind of importance, right? Not all of them, right? C.S. Lewis has some interesting things to say about the love of nature and its value. Here's why I think that's important. It's not that I love trees more than people or I love nature more than people, but there's a certain thing about loving nature. Its independence and indifference to you is more obvious, right? So I aspire to love my wife appreciatively, in terms of her intrinsic goodness, completely independent of me. But in my lived experience, it's almost impossible to disentangle that from a life we've lived together for 30 some odd years where it's not just appreciative love, it's also need love and gift love and these other kinds of loves that we talk about. But it's much easier to disentangle that in terms of nature, right? Yosemite is independent of me, full stop. It doesn't care about me, it's indifferent to me, its goodness and its beauty and its value, if that elicits a kind of love in me, it's completely separate from those other kinds of things. And so that's the reason I think that love of nature can teach us something. It's not that that isn't there in our love of other humans, it's that it's harder to focus at it. It's more tangled up with other kinds of love.
Okay, I think I get that. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I want to give the audience a chance and to ask some questions of Dr. Treanor. So John's going to take this, and he's going to, when you raise your hand, he will come and give you, oh, we've got one right here, John.
Thank you. This is incredible. So beautiful. Thank you, Brian. I have a question. I'm trying to formulate it. But it goes back to a discussion I had recently with some people. About Baudelaire's, I don't know how you translate it in English, Flowers of the Poem.
Yeah.
And how he's trying to show these broken aspects as broken, but at the same time there's this tenderness, and this sort of almost love in the way he's showing them and experiencing them. I'm just wondering, how do we get those new eyes, and does it involve letting go of the ought not to be this way?
Yeah, so I was thinking of our colleague Ian in the back and Galassenheit, and if Robin was around here too, I also talk about Wu Wei, the sort of Taoist concept in there. I do think that part of seeing with new eyes involves both a letting be, a letting other things be what they are, and a letting go of trying to sort of control them and make them into something else. So in that little clip from Terrence Malick, right, what's problematic about what Malick and Thomas Kempis call the way of nature is that the way of nature tries to force other things to conform to it. It tries to impose its will on things rather than accepting them as they are, right? I don't know, I'll have to, now that I'm talking this, I'll have to speak with either you or Ian. Because there's this passage that I quote from Emerson that is also about roses being themselves, the rose without the why of Meister Eckhart and Heidegger. And I wonder if there's some sort of odd cross-pollination there, if Emerson had read Eckhart or something. I don't know. But there's this idea of, you know, looking at a flower and not, again, for my students this semester, like not imposing our categories on it. Like letting it be what it is without asking it to be something else or implying it to be something else, without even sort of, to the extent we can, without even sort of forcing our concepts on it, just letting it be what it is. I think that's part of it. I think that's part of really, I mean, that's part of appreciative love, right? Mm-hmm. Is not imposing my view of a person or another being on it, just letting it be what it is.
Hi, Brian. Thank you for your presentation. I couldn't help thinking of the child spirit in the parable, Nietzsche's parable in Also sprach Zarathustra, of this, this child spirit that says it, I mean, that sees everything as if it were, in some ways, the first time and the last time.
Yeah.
And so I was wondering if you had something to say about that. And to come back on your joke about why you don't say I love you more than once,
yeah.
I was thinking of that too. I mean, as if it were for the first time and last time that you say it. So.
So I've got a whole section in the last chapter about how what I'm writing is not Nietzsche. And the quick answer is there's two reasons. One is Nietzsche's sort of, I won't say his dismissal of faith, but his denigration of religion, right? I mean, I still think of myself as a person of faith and a person of religion, and so this sort of complete dismissing of that, it would be problematic for me. But then secondly is, for people who haven't read Nietzsche, Nietzsche commits himself to a doctrine that he calls eternal recurrence, or the eternal return of the same, right? That Nietzsche thinks that to love the world, you have to love it so fully, so full-throatedly, that you would wish for everything that's happened to happen again, right? That it would just repeat itself infinitely in the future. And what he means, what he means is maybe up for debate. It's a small passage, right? People debate this. But what he seems to me to mean is not just every sunrise and every sunset, every bluebird, every spring, but every genocide, every rape, every murder, every Alzheimer's, every predation, every parasitism. And that to me is obscene, right? That we would wish for that to happen again. I think, and I argue in the book, that we can have an absolutely unqualified, full-throated amor mundi, love of the world, without amor fati, love of fate, love of what's happened in the world, right? Would I like the world to continue to repeat itself into the future? Sure, and I hope we get it better next time around, right? That's where we didn't have time to talk about it tonight, but in the final chapter, I sort of distinguish what I'm talking about from Stoicism and Epicureanism, and I think even more importantly, because it's closer to what I'm talking about, from Nietzsche and Camus, both of whom really start to look in some ways like what I'm talking about here. But I think I've got good reasons to show how I'm different from those two things.
Yes. Whatever. Go.
Students. Thank you, Brian, for this book, and thank you for telling us about it tonight. So in the book, you say some beautiful things about gratitude, and you've mentioned some of them tonight.
Yeah.
But you've also spoken to the sheer indifference of natural things. But in the book, you say that our gratitude simply on its own adds something to the world. And I think that we tend to think of gratitude in some, possibly not exclusively, but in some utilitarian terms. That we say thank you, that I say thank you to you so that you will continue giving me beautiful books.
Right.
But if I say thank you to Yosemite, or to this sunset, or to this tree, it doesn't care. Can you say some words about gratitude?
I mean, I think...
help us out of this hole.
Yeah, that's a good question. It's a really good question. Ian and Brad and some other people will know sort of the Derridean kind of response to this, right? That genuine gratitude or love or friendship or anything, these sorts of things, should be out of the loop of a kind of economic exchange, right? So that if I give you a gift and I'm expecting something in return, it now looks a lot more like bartering than gift giving, right? So real gratitude, I think, would be independent of whether my gratitude is acknowledged or anyway. The little passage on which I'm riffing from that actually comes from this amazing, amazing Scottish author named Nan Shepherd, who wrote she wrote a couple of novels, but she wrote a beautiful little nature memoir called The Living Mountain about her life in the Cairngorm Mountains in Scotland. And she's the one that says that, right? I don't have this one memorized, but it's like, to look into the mountain or to look into nature with a love that is of this sort of nature that your question has in it. I don't have it in my head. It's like to push back the boundaries of non-being. And when I read it, I thought, okay, you know, th- this is entropy gnawing at the edges of existence, and our gratitude. Tentatively, students from this semester, I do sort of think that one thing that distinguishes human beings from other non-human animals is the ability for this kind of appreciative love for gratitude. That if humans went extinct from our own stupidity or other reasons, and the rest of life kept going on the earth, the rest of life would still be good, it would still be beautiful, but it would be missing something without some type of being there to appreciate its beauty and goodness, right? And so there's a quip somewhere in the book that I say, look, something will be lost from the world if Pacific salmon go extinct and their truly miraculous kind of life cycle from the rivers they spawn in down to the ocean and then back 2,000 miles of the Yukon River into Canada. If Pacific salmon are extinct and that's no longer happening, something beautiful will have been lost from the world. But in the same way, if human beings weren't here to appreciate that beauty, something would be lost from the world. So I do think that, you know, philosophers, as you very well know, we're big on talking about our rationality is what distinguishes us from the rest of the world. But I'm kind of proposing in this book that one thing that might distinguish us from the rest of being is our ability to love in a certain way, to be grateful. And again, my students here know I'm perfectly willing to cede all kinds of supposedly human characteristics to animals, from emotions to a share in rationality to even a type of personhood. But I don't see appreciative love there without being sort of anthropomorphic.
Thank you. So you always talk about in class how philosophy to you is like a quest for how ought I to live.
Yeah.
Did you learn anything through writing this book for how you ought to live?
That is a really good question.
That's a good question. Yeah. I thought of that one.
So I tell students in class that I tend to do philosophy myself in a kind of Socratic key, by which I mean not that I'm as smart as Socrates or clever or anything like that, but the first philosophical question that sets its hooks into me has to do with how ought I to live. And then the other questions about metaphysics and epistemology and things like that kind of trail along it. So a bunch of things came from this book. So I don't even think before this book, like I've never been a pessimist, I would say, in the literal sense of that term, expecting pessimus, the worst, right? But I, as a number of my friends here can attest, right, I have a tendency to sort of call the suboptimal kind of thing as most likely to happen. And I don't think that's really a great way to live. Right? I say in a previous book when I was writing about virtue theory that despair is a vice. Right? Even if there are good reasons to despair, we should spit in the face of it. Spit in the face of death and try and fight for a better world. Right? Because I think our lives are better when we're not despairing. So I don't want to despair. That's one thing. I don't like feeling unhappy and miserable. I don't like feeling like climate change is going to total us. But I also don't want to be naive about it, right? I want to look at the world with clear eyes. So what did I learn about how ought I to live? I think that's the kind of thing I was saying at the end of my presentation. I think we all ought to be more joyful and thankful and appreciative than we are in a very, very everyday kind of way, right? Like the end of that Levertov poem, right? Try to acknowledge the next song in its body halo of flame as utterly present, as now or never. But I also think we ought not enjoy that kind of joy. All of us here are lucky. We're all very privileged in a way, right? Think about what's going down in Ukraine now. I don't need to keep coming back to that example. There are lots of others, right? We shouldn't enjoy life at the price of ignoring those kinds of things, right? Yeah, so I think that's what it would have taught me.
We have one last question for the evening.
I think not dissimilar to your question, or at least connected,
I'm wondering about your preference in the final, or the chapter on love, for what I think you called appreciative love.
Yeah.
And then your decision to illustrate that by way of love of nature, which you characterize as, I think, in part, unable to reciprocate. And I'm wondering that about that also in light of your reflection now on the flower, and you're urging us not to impose notions upon it, but to let it be. And I'm wondering about what you would say to the observation that lack of a demand for gratitude, for my gratitude, actually forecloses the exploration, the receptivity to dimensions of being, the being of a person.
Yeah.
Who, if I make a demand, implicit or otherwise, by, for example, saying I'm grateful to you,
yeah,
might reveal dimensions of herself that you're just not going to get,
yeah,
unless there's an implicit response, reciprocate.
Sure.
So I just wonder if, yeah, that would crack open a whole lot more joy, and why you, or has the potential to, whereas you tend, it seems to me, to lead with anxiety about reciprocity, but then have a preferential option for characterizing the implicit request,
yeah,
for a kind of control.
Yeah, I'll have to think about that, because I don't think of myself as having an anxiety about reciprocity.
Yes,
I do want to have respect,
right,
as we discussed in one of my two seminars this week. I do want to have a respect for otherness, that I'm,
right,
not imposing,
right,
on the other. I'll just, because we're getting late here, I'll finish saying one thing here, because I think it answers your question. I don't mean to suggest that appreciative love is sort of the preferred way of always relating,
yeah,
to people in some sort of hierarchy. And I do think that there are all sorts of aspects of love in which reciprocity is not just to be hoped for, but it's kind of necessary. Marcel, who I've mentioned a couple of times, points out somewhere, which I always, when I do philosophy and love to students, I always point out, look, you know, to love someone is to expect something from them, right? This idea that love is blind and you only really love me if you don't ask anything of me, I think is not really what loving another human being is like. That to love someone, you don't want to impose on them, you don't want to control them, but to love is to expect something, I think. But I do think that there's something special about appreciative love. But again, this is in the context of a chapter where I was kind of befuddled, like, what kind of contribution can I make given everything that's been said? So.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Can we get that last poem?
Oh, the last poem in once?
If you guys want it, okay.
Yeah,
so I want to be careful here because I think this one can be misinterpreted a couple of different ways. One, it could be misinterpreted as suggesting the suffering of other people elsewhere in the Ukraine is maybe not such a high priority. I don't think that's what the author means. And two, it could be read as a kind of theodicy where there's a sort of economic justification for the existence of evil. I also don't think that's what he means. So this is Jack Gilbert, A Brief for the Defense. Sorrow everywhere, slaughter everywhere. If babies are not starving someplace, they're starving somewhere else, with flies in their nostrils. But we enjoy our lives because that's what God wants. Otherwise, the mornings before summer dawn would not be made so fine. The Bengal tiger would not be fashioned so miraculously well. The poor women by the fountain are laughing together between the suffering they have known and the awfulness in their future, smiling and laughing while someone in the village is very sick. There is laughter every day in the terrible streets of Calcutta, and the women laugh in the cages of Bombay. If we deny our happiness, resist our satisfaction, we lessen the importance of their deprivation. We must risk delight. We can do without pleasure, but not delight, not enjoyment. We must have the stubbornness to to accept our gladness in the ruthless furnace of this world. To make injustice, the only measure of our attention is to praise the devil. If the locomotive of the Lord runs us down, we should give thanks that the end had magnitude, and we must admit that there will be music despite everything. We stand at the prow again of a small ship anchored late at night in the tiny port. Looking over to the sleeping island, the waterfront is three shuttered cafes and one naked light burning. To hear the faint sound of oars in the silence as a rowboat comes slowly out and then goes back is truly worth all the years of sorrow that are to come. That's Jack Wilbur.
Love it.